I'm going to show you how system simulation could be used to select the proper propulsion system for a roll-on-roll-off passenger vessel, as an example. And we will tackle that through the angle of operational expenditure, so fuel consumption, capital expenditure, so mostly centered around the propulsion system cost, and of course the EEDI compliance, even though it was difficult to make the link for such an exploratory study. Before that, I'll share with you some context, even though you know this context better than me, obviously, but the fact is that we are suffering from stricter regulations, wherever it's IMO 2050, greenhouse gas reduction, or sulfur cap, and there will be many more coming, obviously. And this is nice to see that it's the same image as in the previous presentations. The fact that we have increased competition coming from all over the world when we are developing our a ship or a subsystem. And there is the global recession that has been appearing in 2009, but today is appearing again, and there will be some petrol crisis in the future. So this is a quite big challenge for us. In general. And there is another trend that is driving our developments and technology developments in the ship industry, is the fact that there is a digitalization, appearance of new services, new connected services, autonomous shipping, and stuff like that. So these are quite a lot of challenges, and what do challenges imply for us as shipyards or ship services or classification societies? It means that, especially for pollutant emission, we need to explore alternative propulsion systems, whatever it's new fuels like hydrogen, ammonia, or new technologies like fuel cell, batteries, and so on. The second point is that with more complexity in our ship's propulsion systems, we need to do more and more verification and validation. And in the past, we used to translate that into more and more sea trials, commissioning phases, and so on. On the top of that, I have been muted by host.
No, you're fine.
Ah,
go
okay,
ahead.
Okay, sorry. On the top of that, you can add the complexity that is induced by the autonomous shipping trends or by the connected ship trends, like increasing software and hardware complexity. And you need to tackle those implications without compromising the schedules, the performances of your products, or the dependability and reliability of the products. So my point here is we need to maybe rethink the way we are developing vessels or subsystems like engines or propulsion systems in general. And that's even more true when we see the current situation with the corona crisis. If we rely solely on tests, on a very long supply chain, on physical testing and so on, and if we don't go to a more digitalized approach, we will be less resilient to this kind of crisis. We will be more suffering from the supply chain issues. We will be more suffering from the lack of physical interactions that we had before the coronavirus and so on. So my point here is the fact that by embracing a kind of digital engineering approach, we will be more resilient to such crises and challenges. And this is the reason of being of Siemens Digital Industry Software, is to provide you the ability to create and to deploy a digital twin of your product. A digital twin can rely on several modeling methodologies, and you know quite well some of them. Today I'll focus on system simulation, and I'll explain what this is about, but it can be also 3D finite element analysis. It can be CFD with the well-known STAR CCM Plus solver that is also part of SimCenter. And of course, we still need to rely extensively on tests, because the tests will always be the ultimate proof that your system will work. And of course, a digital twin can be made as a combination of those methods and can be applied to an existing product or can be applied to a future product. And well, having a digital twin is already a good first step, but the vision of Siemens for that is to leverage the digital twin value by connecting it to the CAD. So typically when you do your general arrangement and so on, and your PLM environment, so that you're able to connect your simulation results to the people that are doing the project management, to the people that are building the bill of material, to the people that are taking care of the supply chain. And by doing that, you have a fully integrated method that allows you to front load the design issues, to anticipate the commissioning issues, to have a more high quality C-trials with more incentives coming from the C-trials being ready earlier and so on. So as I said, my area of expertise is the system simulation. So today I'll focus only on system simulation, but bear in mind that having a digital engineering approach can be applied to many different simulation methodologies and testing methodologies as well. So what is system simulation? So if we consider this vessel steering system as an example, a very simple example, what happens? You have a controller or a manual control. It can be a hand or an automatic steering stand that will be driving a starter or an electric machine. This electric machine will be driving a hydraulic system, a hydraulic pump with valves and tanks and actuators. And those actuators will be driving a mechanical system, in that case, the rudder. And when designing such a subsystem, you might ask yourself, is my electric motor powerful enough to steer my rudder from minus 35 to plus 35 degrees under different water conditions? What is the response time of my system? Is there any risk of failure? How this system will handle failure? Is there any risk of vibration coming back from the rudder to the electric motor? And how to optimize the control system to have a most efficient operating system. And system simulations, thanks to the multi-physics approach based on power exchange, dynamic modeling as a function of time, and relying on some validated equations, can answer those challenges and those design issues in a relatively simple and fast manner. Why? Because between each of those components are components that are in AMSIM. So AMSIM is the system simulation tool from the SimCenter portfolio. Behind each of those components, you have some set of equations that are calculating the power and the energy that will be exchanged. Here we have a DC motor that is driving a hydraulic pump through a shaft that has a given inertia. This given inertia will compute the rotational speed based on the torque input on both sides, for example, and so on and so forth. So that's the principle of system simulation. That's the principle of AMSIM. And now let's see how we can apply it to the comparison of different propulsion architectures for Europax. So we have considered a very basic ship with the following characteristics: an LPP of 75 meters, deadweight tonnage of 720 metric tons, breadth of 12 meters, growth of, and so on. And we apply that on a dynamic mission profile. Here it's in second, but it's approximately 1 day of operation, where the ship will spend a lot of time at the port with some hotel loads, average power, and then go out of the port, then go up to the cruising speed, which is 14 knots, and then go back, and then come back on the afternoon, for example. That's a sample mission profile, but in AMSIM, you can input any type of mission profile. It could be GPS data recording, AIS, and so on. And well, based on these inputs, we want to compare several propulsion system architectures. And in this study, we will compare very quickly four propulsion architectures with four different names. So the one on the left would be diesel electric or diesel on demand, where you have two gensets that are supplying through an electric bus, the hotel loads, and the motor drives that will drive the propellers. You have a diesel mechanical architecture where you have two main engines that are driving the two propellers mechanically, and you have one genset that is taking care of the hotel loads. There is the hybrid, which is the same as the diesel on demand, but with the addition of a battery on the electric bus. And finally, you have a kind of mixed architecture where you have one genset, one battery, and you have a PTI PTO and an electric motor and the main engines that are driving the propellers. And the aim is to compare the fuel consumption, fuel oil consumption, and CO2 emissions over one route of one day, one mission profile of one day for those four architectures. So how to do that in MSIM? We will rely on a set of models that are gathering equations, but that are hidden, and where you can modify the parameters of each model to fit your system's characteristics. So here, typically, we would have a variable C conditions model, which will input the wind velocity, the wind direction, the wave's height, wave period, and wave direction, and the water, the seawater viscosity, kinematic viscosity, and density. And you would have a calm sea hull resistance model, which is considering either towing tank test results coming from SSPA, for example, through the EITT C78 method, or CFD data import coming from STAR-CCM+, or Holtrop and Menen data. Then you have your propeller models that can be either KT, KQ maps for both controllable pitch propeller or fixed pitch propeller, or Wageningen B-series for very old propellers definition. And there you can model your propulsion system. In that case here, we have a hybrid system, which is modeled in a very simplified way with two electric motors, one leg ratio here. And those two electric motors are quasi-static models, meaning that you just provide maximum torque curve, minimum torque curve, and efficiency. You have average electric losses for the complete electric system. You have hotel loads that are modeled here, that are constant. You have a battery that can have different battery capacity. And you have two gensets here that can be, again, that are tabulated model where you just provide the maximum torque curve and the fuel consumption the fuel consumption curve, or the SFC, specific fuel oil consumption curve. And by applying your mission profile to control the electric motors, you will be able to follow the required speed. So this is a very simple and first level modeling approach, quasi-static approach, to assess the fuel oil consumption under dynamic sea conditions and dynamic speed conditions for your ship. Of course, if your supplier of the engine, if you're Wärtsilä or if you're WinGD and so on, you can complexify, for example, the engine model and the genset model by adding more details in the engine model, by having access to the peak cylinder pressure, the combustion temperature, the pollutant emissions, and so on. And same for the electric motors. If you're a Siemens electric motor provider, you can have very detailed electric model of the motor with the detailed inverter to have access to, for example, the power quality on your grid, to do some failure analysis in case of short circuit. And here, for example, if you lose one cylinder, what happens? So you can go much more into the details if you want. So that's for the modeling approach. And now let's see some of the results of such a model. And the first conclusion that you can get out of such a model is the absorbed power as a function of the ship speed, which is drawn here. So we start at 500 kilowatts because we have hotel loads of 500 kilowatts. And we are able to determine, so this is in calm sea condition for hybrid architecture, we can determine the minimum power that is required from the propulsion system in order to reach a given speed of 14 knots in that case. Then you can have a look at the dynamic results of your propulsion system. So here on the top left, you can see the simulation results of your ship speed versus your ship speed target. So you can make sure that your propulsion system is able to reach the 14 knots cruising speed. You know what is the distance for one day of operation, in that case 250 nautical miles. And you can understand your engine's behavior, both in terms of engine speed. So in that case, you see that the control was based on the state of charge of the battery. So I didn't display it here, but you see that the engines are starting and shutting down to charge and discharge the battery, which is quite big in that case. And you can see that when we are requiring more power to reach the 14 knots, you need to have the two engines running in parallel. So this is a so-called sequential engine startup control. But you could have a different type of control for the energy management of the ship, having the both engines always running at a given speed and so on. So the control system of such a propulsion architecture is really important to understand the propulsion system's behavior. And my point here is to compare, obviously, the different vessel architectures from an overall fuel oil consumption point of view, but also CO2 emissions point of view, which relates at the end to EEDI standard. Of course, and maybe EEOI is more relevant actually. And here, so we consider as the same MGO fuel for all the architectures, so the CO2 is equivalent to the fuel consumption. But here you can very quickly see the benefit of switching, for example, from a diesel mechanical architecture to a hybrid architecture or to a mechanical assist architecture, because you will lower the fuel consumption and so the CO2 emissions over this one day mission profile. So this value here in tons is the cumulated CO2 emissions and the cumulated fuel oil consumption over one day of operation. So this not only allows you to determine the OPEX, so the fuel oil consumption, at least the OPEX from the fuel oil consumption perspective, but it allows you also to check that you may comply with EEOI or ESEMP regulations. This is the intermediate conclusions. The conclusion for this particular ship with this particular mission profile is the fact that you may want to go for the hybrid architecture. But we didn't show it due to lack of time, but we could explore that. If you change the mission profile with a different cruising speed, with different engines, or with different hotel loads, or other environment conditions, the conclusion might differ. And this is why virtual or digital exploration is useful, because you can do that comparison and that what-if scenarios relatively cheap. In relatively cheap manner and in very quick manner. And last but not least, the hybrid results or the results of the architectures that have a battery are very dependent on the vessel energy management and how you manage how do you use the battery? Do you use the battery for peak shaving only? Do you use the battery for spinning reserve? Do you use the battery as the main propulsive element for a given speed? And this has a very, very important impact on the fuel consumption. And this is why EEDI is only a small part of the solution and the operation. And this has already been said this morning or at the beginning of the conference, the operation and the usage of the ship is very important in the way we will reach the greenhouse gas 2050 targets. What could be the next steps for such a study? So as we presented, we could implement more details into the simulation model. We could have a look at battery aging, at grid stability, engine dynamic performances, genset startup, and so on. This is possible in the same model. We could couple the SimCenter AmSim model to the PLM environment so that we are able to link that to requirements, to link that to the people that are calling the suppliers, that are receiving the data sheet from the suppliers, and so on. We could couple AmSim to SimCenter Star CCM Plus for doing maneuvers analysis, minimum propulsion required in wave, very strong head waves, and this kind of hydrodynamic study that could be done in quite accurate way, full scale in Star CCM Plus. And we could also go further by performing a kind of design optimization study of a given architecture to optimize the engine, the battery, and so on to reach a good trade-off in terms of fuel oil consumption and capital expenditure propulsion system cost. And this is what we're going to do in the second part of this presentation, where we will rely on an optimizer that is embedded into SimCenter's tool suite, which is called HEATS, that is using optimization algorithm to reach design objectives by staying within some design constraints and by using some design variables. So we will apply that to
Roman, you have 5 minutes left.
Five minutes. Okay, so I'll go a bit faster. This is the ship propulsion architecture that we will apply the optimization on. It can be either a pure hybrid or a mechanical assist. So this part of engine that is mechanically connected to the propeller can be removed or not. And the objective of this study is to minimize the OPEX and CAPEX of this ship. And of course, to compute the OPEX and the CAPEX, we need to do assumptions that can be challenged by many, many ways. So just take this as an example and make your own assumptions if you do this kind of study. We consider the MGO price of $667 per metric ton, but it was in December, so now it might be quite lower, so we could redo the study. And for the total propulsion system cost, we considered a very rough assumption, so we didn't have a lot of data to run those assumptions, $1,000 per liter of displacement for the engines, a battery cost that is more automotive style of $200 per kilowatt hour, and a PTI-PTO clutch system of $8,000. And again, I said we want to minimize the fuel oil consumption and the cost of the propulsion system while keeping the cruising speed capabilities over the given mission profile that I have shown earlier, and by making sure the battery state of charge is within its acceptable design limits. So what will we modify? We will modify the architecture. So are we in a hybrid architecture or a mechanical assist architecture? We will compare 5 different engines. So MTU, Volvo Penta mainly, but this is taken as examples. It should not be taken for granted, the conclusion. We will modify some control parameter, which is the speed at which we activate the main engine. The battery capacity, obviously, and the leg ratio before the propeller. So the HEATS optimizer will run many different simulations of the AmSim model and build a kind of Pareto front where you have on the x-axis the fuel oil consumption and on the y-axis the cost of the propulsion system. So in brief, the OPEX and the CAPEX. And the objective is both to minimize the OPEX and the CAPEX. And you can see that the baseline design, so the one that I have shown in the first part of the presentation, is here, and the optimizer itself was able to find a set of configuration that was much lower in terms of fuel oil consumption and in terms of propulsion system cost. So we have a Pareto front. It ran 900 evaluations in nine hours on just a normal laptop like mine. And the conclusions are the following. The first conclusion is on the right, is the fact that the mechanical assist architecture is far more better, and far more better both in terms of OPEX and CAPEX. So you see the red dots are the ones that are mechanical assist, and the blue dots are the ones that are just hybrid architecture. Second conclusion is the fact that the battery capacity doesn't bring a lot of OPEX reduction, while it has a quite big impact on the CAPEX. So here you could take a small battery capacity, you will not lose a lot in terms of OPEX. And when it comes to engines, both for the genset engine and for the main assist engine, it's clear that the Volvo D13 engine brings the best benefit. But again, this is not the true data coming from Volvo, MTU, and so on. This is just for illustration purpose, but how you could assess different engines configuration with different engine powers. And some of these, for example, there is no D8 because 8-liter engine was too small for answering the minimum propulsion power requirements, typically, but D13 was okay if you had four D13 engine instead of two MTU 880 kilowatt engines, for example. So the conclusions are the fact that using this optimizing methods, we were able to reach 40% CAPEX and 32% OPEX improvements compared to the baseline design, which were maybe not very good at the beginning, but still we were able to reach good improvement results. And we got engineering recommendation for your buyers, for example, to go for buying four Volvo Penta D13 engines in an assist configuration with a relatively small battery. And obviously, this study could be challenged in the way that we made some assumptions, but by having data from your suppliers and so on, you would do less assumptions and you would have a more documented story that would enable you to take very good and strong engineering recommendation in order to optimize the OPEX, the CAPEX, and to check that your CO2 emissions are within the limit fixed by the EEDI and EEOI requirements.